Welcome back. Now we're going to discuss how to solve half-life problems in our second video on nuclear chemistry. The first step to solve a half-life problem is to determine the number of half-lives. This will be done by first taking the given total time in the problem and dividing it by the half-life time. We're going to give this a value of n. Then we're going to take our grams that are provided and divide by 2 raised to the n. So you'll take your given grams divided by 2 to the n. Let's do a couple of examples so this makes a little bit more sense. The half-life for nickel 63 is 100 years. How much of a 200 gram sample would remain after 300 years? So the total time is always the larger amount. So in this case, the total time is 300 years. And we're going to divide by the half-life time of 100 years to get 3. The second step is to take the number of grams provided, the 200, divided by 2 raised to our answer, which is 3. So 200 divided by 2 to the third should give you 25 grams for your answer. In addition to solving problems this way, you can also be asked to solve a backwards problem. So here you are asked for the number of grams that would remain. In this bottom question, it's asking instead, what is the half-life? So you're going to work backwards. You first have to figure out how many half-lives have gone by based on the grams. And then you can calculate the actual half-life. So here's how I like to do this. I start with the given grams. If I take my 2 grams divided by 2, I get 1. And if I take my 1 gram divided by 2, I get 0.5. So I divide it by 2 twice. Therefore, there are 2 half-lives in this problem. Then I take the given total time, which is 42 hours, and I divide it by the number of half-lives to get 21. So the answer to this question is that half-life is 21 hours. At this time, please pause the video and use the examples to assist you in solving the next 2 problems. Please check your answers. For the first problem, you should have seen that there were 5 half-lives and that there would be approximately 10.9 grams left after these 5 half-lives have gone by. For the second problem, it was asking you to calculate half-life, so it was a backwards problem. You should have gotten 4 half-lives to go from 8 grams to 0.5 and then take the total given time divided by 4 to find that the half-life is about 14 days. The next part of the chapter is to discuss a little bit about nuclear power. Fission is the splitting of atoms. I kind of like to think of it as something fizzing out. Helps me remember it. A good example of a fission reaction is most of our nuclear reactors. As you can see in the diagram here, a neutron is bombarded into uranium, and that uranium breaks into a whole bunch of pieces in addition to more neutrons, and energy is released. Fusion is the opposite, so it's the joining of atoms. And I remember that because I'm fusing things together. A good example for this one is our sun. Hydrogen combines with hydrogen to produce helium. And you can see from the diagram that we have 2 smaller particles fusing together to produce 1 larger particle, as well as energy. The next part of the chapter is all about uses of nuclear medicine and, you know, how is nuclear chemistry used in science. There's a lot of applicable techniques that we see. Ionizing radiation is something that causes changes in cellular biochemical processes that can damage or kill a cell. Therefore, things like radiation therapy or chemotherapy. So, nuclear chemistry is used for dating techniques, for fossils and forensics. This is usually carbon-14, because it's radioactive. Lots and lots of different types of cancer treatments, chemo, radiation therapy. It can be used for tracers. Iodine-127 is radioactive, and sometimes you'll be asked to drink a radioactive tracer so that they can get a better picture of your thyroid. Sometimes for MRIs it's used. There's also scans like the SPECT scan, the PET scan. There's a MUGA scan. There's a lot of different ways that tracers are used to kind of help enhance quality of images. As well, it says they're imaging, so MRIs, x-rays, gamma cameras, and then there's a pretty cool one that I put on here because I just thought it was awesome. They can actually inject radioactive gold into certain tumors, and it has been proven to kind of make them decrease and eventually go away. The final slide in the PowerPoint is on measuring radiation. And it just kind of briefly discusses some of the ways that radiation is detected. We have photographic imaging, computer imaging, they can use a Geiger counter, they can use film badges. Okay. And the definitions are provided here for you. There are also a variety of different units of radiation. We have the curie, which is used to measure activity, usually, becquerel, a rad, as well as a few others. And that concludes our study of nuclear chemistry.